Hi class, Dr. Jim here. Today we're going to be looking at two different topics. First, we're going to be focusing on what the cell structure is and what is a cell and what is the structure and why cells are so small. The second thing we're going to be looking at is what is a prokaryotic cell. A prokaryote is a cell that lacks a nucleus. These were the first cells on the planet Earth and then eventually evolved to eukaryotic cells. And we're going to discuss more about eukaryotes next time in the next lecture. And so it's a nice stepwise progression. Start with the prokaryotes and then move on to the eukaryotes. And so our objectives today are looking at why are cells so small. So you may have thought previously, hey, why am I not just one giant cell? Why are we made up of hundreds of millions of tiny little cells? The second thing we're going to be looking at is what is a prokaryote. I already alluded to a little bit, these are cells without a nucleus, but we'll discuss a little bit more about their structure and shape and a few other things about them. And then finally, we're going to look at some important aspects of these prokaryotic cells. We're going to look at some of the external structures and some of the internal structures that prokaryotes have that are slightly different than what we see in eukaryotes and why these things are important. And then hopefully this will give you a better appreciation for some of the prokaryotes that are out there. And that not more than just thinking of bacteria that cause illness or bacteria that causes something to be stinky or, you know, rotten, you want to throw it out. So this will hopefully give you a little bit better appreciation of what a prokaryote is. So let's start. Okay, so to begin with, cells are the smallest units of living matter. Now, Jill has done a wonderful job in the past of talking about what atoms are, what matter is, and what even organic molecules are. And we talked about those things, and now we're putting them all together and forming what is called a cell. Now, a cell is the smallest living unit. Okay, and we'll discuss more about what makes something alive versus not alive. We alluded a little bit to that in chapter one, but we'll talk more specifically about why is a cell alive and why a virus isn't when we get to chapter 20, and I have some good explanations there. But for now, just think of the cell being the smallest living unit. The second thing we're going to look at is the different types of cells. The first two you've seen already in lab. We did this in the first week of lab, in which you guys peeled the onion skin and you put it on a slide and you added a little iodine. And what you saw was that you had these nice little cells that kind of look like bricks on the slide. Now my bricks are purple because they were stained with a different color, but you saw these nice little yellow bricks. And what these little structures are around the cell are the cell wall. And they give a lot of structure to these guys. They give them a very solid structure. They're very tightly packed. And so you think of a plant and that's how they grow. Very tightly packed, very strong structure because their cell walls are their skeletons in them to give them support. Now, animal cells are slightly different. We worked on these as well. We did our cheek cells. We scraped the sides of their cheeks, and we put those on a slide. And what I like to describe them as in the lab is fried eggs or fried egg appearance. And that's because our cells lack a cell wall. We do not have cell walls that give us that nice little structure that plant cells do. And so our cells are allowed to kind of more freely move around and kind of have their own structure and function. It makes them a little bit different. Of course, it makes up an organism in that, but we don't have those cell walls to give us this nice structured brick-like appearance. We have more of this kind of just irregular appearance of what our cells look like. Now, the third type of cells, which you guys are actually going to be looking at in the lab, are these bacteria cells. Now, bacteria, in the way that this looks, makes it look like they're very large, but in fact, they're actually much smaller. Bacteria are anywhere from 100 to 1,000 times smaller than the average plant or animal cell. And so these guys are actually very, very tiny. And when you look at them in the lab this week, you're actually going to have a difficult time because they are so small. They are very tiny. They're much harder to find than a typical plant or animal cell are. And you're going to see these cells in the lab. Now, kind of just to give you a perspective, these little holes here allow water to pass through. This is actually a filter, and you can see that these bacteria are very small. If you can see holes for a filter, you can kind of get the idea of how small these bacteria cells really are. And so just to kind of give you an idea how tiny these are. So why are cells so small? Well, it really comes down to the idea of surface area. So we could go through all the math and complicated formulas and everything else, but I'll just give it to you easy and straight. What we're worried about is the surface area, or how much surface is actually exposed. So think of it in this way. We have one large box with eight sides, or we have 8 smaller boxes, which actually have 64 sides, or we have 64 boxes, which now have 64 times 8, which is, I believe, 384 sides. And so if you look at that, we're talking about how much surface area you have. And so that actually makes it very important. You can see the volume is the same. If we did the height times the width times the length and then multiplied how many boxes we have, we'd have the same volume for all three. Where that changes is the total surface area. And that's important. How much absorbing can we do? Okay? It's kind of the same principle that our intestines work on. So due to the surface area, more surface area, the more molecules can get in and out of the cell. And this is called cell transport. And we're going to talk all about transport in Chapter 5. And that will be the next set of lectures that we do next week. Okay, so we look at the cells again. More surface area equals more efficiency. And our bodies do the same thing. You think of our intestines. Our intestines aren't just hollow tubes. They actually have lots of ridges on the inside. And those ridges increase the surface area. More surface area allows you to absorb more food and more nutrients. And that's why we do those things. And so that's really important. And so we actually have ridges, these villi inside our intestines, so we can absorb more food. So that's one of the reasons, more surface area. The second thing is, think of it on a larger scale. If I put you at the city limits of Los Angeles and made you walk to the center, it would take you a long time. Now we'll do the same test, and now I'll put you at the city limits of Green Bay and make you walk to the center. Still, it'll take you a long time, but not nearly as long as it would take you to walk to the center of Los Angeles. And so think about that, getting to the center of the cell. If you're one giant cell, it's going to take you a long time to make it to that center. And so by that idea of getting to the center of the cell, it's going to take you a long time. That's not very efficient. Whereas if you're small cells, you can get in very quickly, get to the center, and then get back out again. Much more efficiency. So it has a lot to do with the efficiency of the cell. We're very small cells because we want to be more efficient. Okay? And if you need more explanation, I definitely recommend going and watching this video. This is a nice little laboratory video kind of describing the same thing I talked about, the surface area and how fast things get to the center. And it does a really good job. So it only is a 4-minute video, but click on this in my YouTube channel. I recommend it. It'll make this really stand out and say, oh, now I get it. Okay, the light bulb will come on. So the second part of the lecture we're going to look at are, what are prokaryotes? Prokaryotes actually means before nucleus. Karyote actually stands for center or before the center. And so prokaryote, before center, means no nucleus. And so these cells lack a nucleus. They lack organelles. And these are the ones that are typically what we call our bacteria. And the bacteria you associate with are things like Staph aureus or E. coli or maybe even Salmonella. You might hear these in the news or even might have to deal with these things. And then we also have the other type of bacteria called the archaebacteria. And the archaebacteria are these weirdo bacteria that grow in very extreme environments. These guys are found in areas like the hot springs found in Yellowstone, or maybe if you go out to Salt Lake City and you go put your feet into the Salt Lake. These things grow in these very extreme environments where you won't find anything else growing in them. And so these guys can survive and thrive in these environments. And so we call these the archaebacteria. They're very similar. They don't have a nucleus, but they're different because they're the way that they live in their extreme environments. Okay. So I like to bring up this slide just to give you a kind of a representation of what the prokaryotes are. We all brush our teeth every day. And you think about when your teeth get kind of slimy and you're ready to brush them, those are actually the bacteria that are growing on your teeth. We can take those bacteria that you brushed off your teeth and actually plate them. And if you guys take microbiology as a class, you're actually going to get to plate bacteria and grow them up onto a plate. And you're actually going to see these types of structures. If we take these bacteria that are here and we blow them up into looking at them under the microscope, you're going to see that they have a definite shape. They have a definite size and a definite shape, and that gives them some structure and function. We're going to talk a little bit about that in just a minute. But if we blow up what is actually growing in your teeth, you can see that it's not just one type of bacteria, but several different types. We have round bacteria. We have these little rod-shaped bacteria. We have some of these others that don't really have a shape. And they have a wide variety of different bacteria. It's not just one type, but a jungle, a sense essentially growing on your teeth. You have a lot of different bacteria growing around. And now I know most of you are probably licking your teeth wondering how many bacteria do I actually have on there. But we'll worry about that for another day. Okay. So like I did mention, there are some distinct shapes. There are three distinct shapes that we'd like you to know. The first one being the ball or round shape. This is called the coccus. And you might be aware of these bacteria. You might have heard these before, Staphylococcus aureus or Staph aureus. These bacteria are round shaped. These are the ones that cause MRSA and can cause problems with infections and things like this. We then have the second type of bacteria called the bacillus, which are the rod-shaped bacteria, or which I like to call the hot dog shape. They kind of have that hot dog or wiener type shape, so you can think of it like that, the hot dog-shaped bacteria. And then the third type of bacteria are the spirillium. And the spirillium are really interesting because they're spiral-shaped bacteria. They kind of look like a corkscrew. And there are actually two different types of diseases that you might be aware of that you may have heard of before. One of them that's caused by this disease or is caused by these bacteria is called Lyme disease. These bacteria get spread by getting bit by ticks. You can get this in Wisconsin if you're out and about and get bit by a tick. These bacteria end up in your joints and actually can cause some destruction in your joints and you get arthritis and things like that. Another corkscrew-shaped bacteria like this is called syphilis. And syphilis, obviously, or the diseases cause syphilis, and the bacteria that causes syphilis is a corkscrew-shaped bacteria, very distinct. And so if you have a localized infection caused by syphilis, they can do a skin scrape and they can find these bacteria on it. Or, you know, other things like that. And so I just wanted to point those different things out. I think people like to hear about diseases and that stuff, and that's one of them. There are two of them that are caused by the spiral. Now, if we look at some of the outside structures, so there's not a lot on the inside. Most of the fun stuff and bacteria are found on the outside. One of the things that we see are flagella. Now, flagella can be found either as one long tail, or they can have multiple flagella in the bacteria, or they can have two flagella depending on where they have them. But these are structures that allow bacteria to move. And the way that they move is they spin their flagella around like a little propeller. So think about like a motorboat or an airplane that has a propeller and how it spins. This is how the bacteria move their flagella, and then that allows them to go forward, and then they can stop and tumble and move away and do those different types of things. And that's called their movement or locomotion. And so they have that taxis to either do to light or chemicals and that stuff, and they use their flagella to move. Now, another structure bacteria have are called these fimbriae, and fimbriae allow for the bacteria to stick. These are like hair-like structures, or what I like to call bacterial Velcro, and they stick to bacteria or stick to things. And so when we go back to the idea of bacteria sticking to your teeth, a lot of times it's due to these fimbriae. These hairs allow you to stick. Now, the last structure that some bacteria, not all, have is what is called a pilus. And a pilus allows for bacteria to exchange DNA. So this picture is a little X-rated in the way that we'll call that this is really what's going on is bacterial sex, and that this bacteria here is donating bacteria to this guy. And this pilus acts much like what a penis would, and they allow DNA to go from one cell to another. Okay? And so we call this the pilus, or the pilus structure that the bacteria has. Okay, so that's some of the outside structures that bacteria have. Now, if you really want to see a cool video of bacteria moving, it's very hypnotic and it gets you into a trance. You can watch these guys spin around and use their flagella. I recommend clicking on this link that I have here or on my YouTube page when you get off this lecture. Okay, the next structure as we move in are the cell walls. And cell walls are the structures that give and maintain the shape of the bacteria and also provide protection for the bacteria. There are two types. You may have heard this if you worked in a hospital before, the gram-positive bacteria and the gram-negative. And this is based on how they stain. And the way they stain is based on what their cell walls do. Now, gram-positive has a very thick cell wall, and they soak up stain like a big thick sponge. So think of a big sponge when you think of a gram cell. And what happens is that a gram positive will soak up the purple stain. They don't lose it through their decoloring, and they remain purple all the way through. And so those are the gram positive bacteria. Now then, so thick cell walls soak up the purple stain. That's why they stay purple. Now another type of bacteria are the gram negative. The gram negative have thin cell walls that don't soak up the stain well. They consider them like paper towels. Sure, they soak up the stain, but you can easily get rid of the stain after washing them a few times. And so when you take these guys to the stain, they soak up the purple, but because their membranes are so, or their walls are so small, they actually lose their stain, and then when you counter stain, they end up being pink or pink or red. And so we call these the gram negatives. And so what I really want you to get out of this is think of gram positive being very thick, gram negative being very thin. And we'll discuss this more when we get into chapter 20 when we discuss the specifics of bacteria and why those are. But I just wanted to give you a heads up now on some of the differences in the gram positive versus gram negative. Now, on the inside of the cell wall, there's a cell membrane. These cell membranes are the same phospholipid bilayers that all cells have. So this is no different than what a plant cell or an animal cell would have. So I'm not going to spend any time talking about this. We're going to spend a lot of time on cell membranes in the next set of lectures and next week's lectures. So we'll save that discussion for next week. Now, when we get on the inside of the cell, we don't really have a whole lot. So most of the fun stuff on the inside of the bacteria cell or on the bacteria cell is actually on the outside. And so on the inside, you have some DNA, and this is found in what they call the nucleoid region. It's not a nucleus, but the nucleoid region. It also has some ribosomes. Ribosomes are used for making proteins, and we're going to discuss that more when we talk about eukaryotes. And then they have some of these small little pieces of DNA called plasmids. It allows these bacteria to survive certain environments that they wouldn't do so well in if they didn't have them. And we'll talk more about this again when we get into the bacteria. But most of the inside of the bacteria is this cytoplasm or water. So what I like to describe bacteria or prokaryotes are is basically a bag of water with some DNA and ribosomes on the inside. And that's really what a bacteria or prokaryote is. Okay? Not much to see on the inside. So if we summarize this, we talked about two things. First, we talked about why cells are small, and that has to do with the surface to volume ratio or the surface area. More surface area, more efficiently things get in. Smaller cell, the faster you can get to the center. So think about that. Efficiency is the way that happens. The second thing we discussed were prokaryotes. They're not exciting cells, but they do a lot. Okay, there are a lot of them around. They grow on us. They live on us. They're all around us. And so it's important to know what prokaryotes are, what they do. They don't have a nucleus. They don't have organelles, but they've been around here for a long time. These were the first cells on the planet, and they'll probably be the last cells on the planet as well. So if you think about these things, the prokaryotes are really well adapted to this Earth. And with that comes to the end of this lecture. If you have any questions for me, send me an email. I'd be happy to discuss anything that you've gotten out of this lecture. Otherwise, proceed on to the next lecture so that you can learn about the eukaryotes. And if you have any questions during lab class, feel free to ask. And we'll see you the next time. Thanks.